December the 17th, 1997. I'm conducting an interview with Mrs. Edith Wolfe. We are in London. The language spoken is English, and this is tape number 9. How did your experiences during the Holocaust affect your life?
I mentioned this shortly before. Through life hasn't been easy because I didn't have the opportunity to talk. The reason I told you was one of the reasons. And, you know, people are not interested in what happened in the past, not many people, and you can't just talk. People don't want to listen to sad stories. And I am not a person who like to talk about bad things just because I went through something. It's difficult. Why should someone, I always used to say, why should someone listen to me? Because I went through something. Why should I bother and spoil someone else's? Somehow, obviously it harmed me because it has been harming me tremendously. Because when someone, it's so logical, if you can get everything out of you, then you get rid of all your problems. It's problems the same. If you can talk, you ease your problems. And because I couldn't talk, then I'm lately better. Not only just now. I've been lately better, but I had been until, say, a year ago. I had been reliving the past. And it was tremendously hard. And, in Prague, after I somehow jumped over to something else, I was very ill after the war because I just got infected. Everything came back suddenly, a high temperature and a little bit something on my chest. But it was okay. But psychologically, I suffered. I had somehow not big, but sort of nervous breakdown. I couldn't work. I couldn't do it. I couldn't study. I was studying. I couldn't do anything. And it was hard. I refused to be treated. It was, again, I was very strong-minded. I don't know. Maybe it helped me. Maybe it harmed me. But again, I was strong-minded. I turned down and when I was doctors and I had an offer to go to sanatorium, whatever. I said, no, I won't get a stamp for my life or get because I wasn't mad. They would take me as a mad. I was just, after all this experience, I was just run down with my nerves, with everything. And I said, no, it didn't exist like today, so to talk to someone or some place or didn't exist. Well, anyway, then I survived. I did study. It was hard, but I carried on with reliving my past. And I, after all, I couldn't sleep. I had to ask for sleeping tablet, and I did take sleeping tablets.
Did you have nightmares? Mm-hmm.
That's what I said, literally reliving my past night after night, absolutely, everything. All these stories, especially with all those dead bodies, all these horrible experiences, horrible. If was horrible. And then I got some sleeping tablets, and I got used to the sleeping tablets, which was horrible. And I was given some antidepressant tablets, and I started taking antidepressant tablets. And I said to myself, oh no, you are doing, because I used to be such a strong person, I said, oh no, you are doing the wrong thing. And it was 1976, I had a hysterectomy, and I was really very, with my nerves absolutely down, and they put me on stronger tablets, and it was even worse. And I said, and that's it. Put yourself together, be strong as you used to be, and chuck everything out. I couldn't throw out. It's a bit slang. No, I did throw. Honestly, I just wouldn't take any depressant tablet. What? They continue. You have to take them. They used to give me Librium, Valium, other names, pink tablets. What names? I can't remember. I didn't take straight to the loo. In the dustbin. I was scared someone will pick it up. Loo. And after many years, I said, can you please cross it out from my file? No way, said Dr. Gibbons, because you got prescription. I said, I chucked it out to the toilet. I never took any of those, only for a very short time. I did take sleeping number. But anyway, I don't care, because I didn't, I just wouldn't. And I was really getting better. I did carry on with sleeping tablets. And again, I said to myself, put yourself together and try it out slowly. And gradually, I said to myself, I just couldn't go on like this. And at first, I was very busy, and I tried to be very busy, not just with sex, because I had to retire. What I didn't say, this was a horrible part of my life. It happened while I was working Marks and Spencer. I was in horrible back pain, and I was very, very ill advised by an orthopedic surgeon to go and undergo an operation. They promised me just to take out one vertebrae and a disc, a small fusion. They never asked. They didn't get my signature. And they carried on with they didn't ask my husband. And they carried on with major operation in Stanmore Hospital. 6 vertebrae and a disc. Big fusion. I've got metal rods supporting my spine from top to the bottom, and I had to retire on a house ground for Max and Spencer, and this destroyed me completely.
Did your back trouble stem from the time that you were doing
your
gardening
work? Absolutely, absolutely. This is what happened. Because all the heavy wheelbarrows, you see now, I couldn't remember that. And all the space, the heavy, when I dug in a earth and turning over, I mean, all day, all the heavy, everything. It was, my bones were soft. They were not developed. And obviously, it's how it started. And don't forget, I was just after the rheumatic fever. Everything was just... didn't help. Marks and Spencer didn't help, because I had to work very hard before I became a supervisor. It was extremely hard and didn't help. Well, then I retired from health ground.
How did your experiences in the Holocaust affect your faith, your religious identity, your Judaism?
Well, be honest, I always kept tradition. But even my father and my mother, they kept tradition. But my mother somehow believed, but not much. My brother, he studied Talmud, he was extremely. But I myself, I never used to be a believer. I sort of tried to skip my, well, I did go to Sunday classes, but I was a nuisance. And I just wanted to know everything. Yes, I did want to know everything. I studied, literally studied Judaism, starting in Theresienstadt, and even after I wanted to know everything, history. I know everything about history, everything. But religion, no. I'm not really a religious person. And even after, actually, I wasn't as bad before as after. Some people are turning the other way around. They turning to religion, to God or whatever. There is one God for everyone. Everyone has a choice. But I myself am saying it's my personal philosophy. My personal philosophy. If, you know, it's not like a fiddle on the roof. I love it. no. Turning to God about the daughters. Yes, I did ask, how is it possible if there is someone to allow not only 6 million Jews to be murdered? Not only my own brother, but six. All family, all my mother, most of practically all my mother's brothers, sisters. But all of the rush, I mean, in Russia, what happened, the whole world, whatever. I mean, if there is someone, how can someone allow not everyone, I mean, 6 million people couldn't be a sinner and to do all their life things wrong, or if adult did things wrong, what the little babies and chill all the children. And this was my philosophy and still is my philosophy, has been all the time. What about all the little children, everything? I mean, they didn't do anything, they didn't harm anyone. Well, I know it's against you, against my closest brother's philosophy, this is we argue, but because he was strong-minded and he did know I was strong-minded, even as a very young person, and he didn't try to, he started, but he gave up very soon because he did know there was no way to talk me to someone to convert, because I explained it to him, my point of view, and sometimes I shake, really, I was shaken, really, even with this Talmud, because I was very, very, honestly, it's my, I respect, because William was used to be very religious in a family, but because they were so strict Orthodox, they turned the children, not against, but a little bit. And he still carried on, obviously, with religion, but he wasn't Orthodox, be very honest, only because the father was so strict. But obviously, he studied Talmud, everything. But
you mentioned to me when we met the first time that you had never registered yourself as having survived.
And not even now.
The Holocaust.
That's my first.
Why is that?
Well, I've got still the form with me, empty, not very well. Well, because I somehow felt cross or I felt harm when I heard, even from my own husband, when he was talking and talking, actually, he had tapes with his recordings about his story. And as I said, we were an adult and it went so on. And he said I was in a spa or whatever, I mean, nothing. Then I said, well, if I was in a spa, why should I talk? And on top of everything, I know personally about quite few people. They not only talk a lot and didn't tell the truth. Sometimes they lied. But they used to write books and books about things what didn't happen or what I know they didn't happen. And there were quite few people even recently on television. I wouldn't put names on it. But it was really... I didn't take it quite nicely, because there were quite serious people, very honest, but there were quite few, and they were telling lies, not only lies, honestly, because I know it wasn't true, and somehow it has been discouraging me to talk about things, horrible things, because if they are not telling the truth and are lying, why should someone say I am telling the truth? And not only this, why should I, when I am not a liar and I wouldn't say a word what isn't true, because, not because I am the honest person, because I have been mistaken, I did a lot of mistakes in my life, and I am not an angel. I get very well on with young people, and that's okay. But the problem is, I have a proof. No one, I have never, ever, and I am very, very cross. And you can send a report, I am telling you now, to Steven Spielberg, because I was cross with the film. Not because of the, he did a fantastic job. Kova Kavot. Thank you for him. He did a job. For all the other people, they wouldn't learn anything. Children, school, he started it. Fantastic. Thank you. But the story, as such, I'm sorry, he followed something what Keelan, what was his name, in Australia, wrote a book of someone, a Polish Jew, said something. I could prove it, but was not everything correct. Anyway, just because the people, I know one so far, No one in a book on television has proved what he said. What I am saying now, point by point, not copies or something fabricated. I have original of everything.
Which we will
including
see.
Including original photographs. I've got originals of everything. I carried it on my own body. Sometimes, even I'm so clean, and I used to be clean, I had to be unwashed because I didn't want loose, because I couldn't take shower in front of someone else, and I wouldn't take off my, what is a car, piece of car paper, my number. Not the other one, the higher one, you know, that's nothing. It was further on, but my main number is 289, and I would never take it off. This is why it's so filthy, and it's so, it's with original, even with original, everything. And no one so far, since 1945, proved me right, proved me he is telling the truth. And this is why I'm cross, and this is why I haven't been I haven't been willing to talk, because I just couldn't believe it how people. Because honestly, many things were literally fabricating.
Why did you come forward to tell your story today?
Actually, I saw a program 3 years ago,
Oprah Winfrey.
Steven Spielberg there was a program, and there was a lady who met her husband, an American soldier, he liberated, they married, and so very quickly. And she was telling the truth. She wrote a book, and she was, I wasn't about I know everything. I actually, I'm very, you know, I do whatever I do before I say anything. I do research because I read a lot. I did my own research. And she was telling the truth. Everything is fine. But the people that were on television were telling lies. And because I know it. And on a Steven Spielberg program, I said, well, that's fine. I wrote a short letter to America, but I never got an answer. I wrote down my address, but I don't know, maybe I did some, or maybe so many people are writing, they were not interested. Because I just make a short, very short, brief letter. Maybe I should. But this time there was a lunchtime short program on ITV, and there was Mrs. Kruntz. And she said, time is running out. If there is someone who wants to talk and put the record straight on whatever, say it now. It's time is running out. And I said to myself, oh, when you are 69 years old, I was 69 on the 1st of September, I said, well, time is really running out. And I suddenly did come to the conclusion, and I rang up my phone and phone up, and there was an answering machine. I left my address, and I was given a telephone number. I rang up again because I said to myself, no, that's not good enough. I would leave it, and no. They probably won't phone. I know the blah, blah stories. They will ring back. They won't. I didn't. I somehow I'm not very, because of the experience, many, many bad experiences, then I'm not, I don't trust everyone now. And I rang up Mrs. Grant on a mobile phone because they gave me, and second time I rang up, they gave me a mobile phone. As soon as I phone, she was very kind, immediately, I was very brief in point, and I said, I've got origins, not like other people, they are talking. I've got everything. So how you can have everything? You can't have origin. I said, well, you say you've got, I've got everything. And I say, I've got everything. Oh, okay. Then she was just flying out from Gatwick to Dublin, I think. And she said she will bring me back. Fortnight passed, she didn't. I said, oh, well, another story. Why I bothered? I was angry with myself. I said to Ivan, my last time I ever contacted anyone, because no one. I wasn't. And he was really, he was before me, and he was, she will ring, she will, and she did. She apologized, she went somewhere else, and she did. And this is how it ended. The end of. But I'm still not registered. I still didn't write. And actually, everyone, because we lost our family and everything, we lost everything. But because, maybe, because I wasn't bothered about materialistic things, and I actually could get, you know what, for 50, I have only for 2 years I have been receiving money. All those years I didn't get a penny. I was literally struggling. I've been struggling. And I could have money, but somehow, because probably I'm not materialistic enough, and this was silly, because I mean I could have been living a better life, but for all those reasons I didn't. And suddenly William said, he himself thought it was really silly. And he said, don't you think that you should, because he applied. And unfortunately, came too late for him as well. He died before. That's it. And what happened was, he asked me, do something quickly. He brought me the form, because I wouldn't go for a form. He wrote for a form, we filled a form, I filled a form, and sent all my documents. I've done everything, and obviously they couldn't believe it. Why? For God knows so many years, because I could have mentioned everything. Now I'm okay now, but unfortunately.
It's December 17th, 1997. I am conducting an interview with Mrs. Edith Wolfe in London. The language spoken is English, and this is tape number 10. Is there anything else you would like to add at this point that you may not have mentioned until now?
Probably. Let me just a few seconds or minute ago. About the whole affair, about the whole situation, I think the people, all the people's attitude is they want to tell their stories. I've been through exaggerating, telling things. They wanted to make themselves, I don't know if somehow more, I don't know, interesting or whatever the reason. And this is why somehow I said to myself, everyone is telling this. I mean, why should I tell? Or I just couldn't. I was really fed up. I just really, I heard so many stories. You know, I don't want harm people. I won't talk about William. No. I mentioned it, it's true, but there are famous people, very famous, died very shortly. He was the one of the highest. And very well known to us, and friend, and he was telling, and on television all the time, and writing, and lecturing, and lecturing, and writing on television, and I've got to say, I said to myself, have another proof. I'm honestly, I'm probably horrible, not only because I've got all my proof, that's fine, that's fact, but I wanted the fact to have on my tape. Because William was very close to him, and and he didn't like it, but didn't matter, but it mattered to me. And then I taped everything, every time there was a speech, I make the tape, and I've got it, two tapes, because I few things, not, I mean, very honest, there are many things, hundreds of things, all right, but there are quite few, not all right, really. I can prove it. But it's past. But it hurts. And that's, you know, you ask me the reason, so many reasons, not from little people. I hope you understand. If you hear those stories from little people, or many from Poland, they can hardly express themselves. Yes, I've got problems because I was betting my English. I lost touch, I read a lot, but obviously I'm not talking now. But they can hardly express themselves. And they are telling stories, unbelievable stories, what I can prove they are not. But fine, there are uneducated people or little educated people. There are people, I can forgive them, and I forgave them. But not people, they They are in they had been in a high in high places and in high education and lecturing. I couldn't really swallow this, and I couldn't forgive, and I couldn't, and it was harming me extremely. And honestly, it's just, and every time I said, okay, go and do something, every time, oh, not another holiday, or not another speech, or leave it. And I said, no, chuck it. And I left, put it in a drawer, forget it. It's back in a drawer. But obviously now a little time passed since, and I should have done something because it's difficult.
It is now over 52 years since the end of the war. Is there a message that you would like to leave for your children, future grandchildren, and for humanity at large?
Yes. They should a little bit listen to, because we won't be here for too long. How many people, how many years have got? Difficult. They should, if they can't listen, because young people are not able to listen to older generation, I know, because I'm friendly with young people, and I know because not many old people have a proper attitude. They are talking and, like, I don't know, they're talking and talking in not proper way to young people. I did one lecture in a synagogue, but I did a research and I put it in writing first, and I did, and they were absolutely thrilled. But you have to approach properly. What I could have as a really advice is to go and start with a film, like Spielberg film, what if even, I mean, it has nothing to do with them, but they can learn something from the past, even if it's one story, but they can see what happened. And they, fortunately, because Steven started, and few people here started, Jenna is good, it's now in museum, it's going in at long class, in curriculum, in the lectures, in school. It was never accepted. It's still not accepted in East Bloc, so-called East Bloc. It's at long class in Germany, law now. It's already, you know, it's already in a, written in a book. They have to learn about everything. And obviously, it's not much here, but it's supposed to go somehow. But I can hear on television, there was on 11th of November, there were quite few young people. They are learning, but slowly. What I could advise the young generation to go and read, start in school, even encourage their own teacher to learn, because the problem is the teacher, they know nothing. It is the same like with maths. In our days, the knowledge was absolutely fantastic. In these days, it's pure in everything, in all subjects. How they can, they have no knowledge about history, about past. What they shouldn't ask about if they can't learn in school, they could dig and start digging themselves. Go, it's easy. There are books, there are films, and go to the history and try to learn something. It's so easy. So many things been written. They don't need to read books, simple things, but learn about past. To my children, well, it's I'm a bit sad about it because it's the first generation, and most probably they got fed up, I presume. I think so. Because William was talking a lot about concentration camp. And I think they somehow got fed up. And because I didn't know. And about, I mean, you can tell something the children, but only shortly on, or only in like tablets. You can't swallow the whole lot at the same time. You have to take them two by two, one by one. And if you take too much, that's it. I don't want to hear anything. And I think my son just got fed up. They have listened to the, not different, to the same stories too many times. And obviously, why should I tell them another story? What was sort of another story. But when I said something, then I said to Ivan, I said, you know about this, what about you organization? And he said, that's good. I said, well, at long last, someone is going to listen. And I told him, I said, can you remember the crocodiles when I mentioned something? And I started crying because I was really, it was a time and it was still hurting. And you told me, stop your crocodiles, your tears. He couldn't say anything. And Hanus, I did a few things to Hanus because I his father told him a lot. Then I did tell him only a few things, what not. And well, again, I told him, if you want to know, I won't tell you anything anymore. If you are interested, there are books, there are films. If you haven't got time to read books, go see a film, go to a museum, and just or read something what I put down on paper, because I put few things down on paper. He never, Ivan, of course, because it was, but Hanush wasn't interested. But yesterday, I think after yesterday, we had some discussion yesterday. And he was a bit moved, and maybe he somehow, because I told him, I said, I won't be here for long, and you are the first generation. But my main point is, and this is what I told them, I said, it's been hurting because all everything, including them, not only those people, but them as well, because I know whatever I said word by word is true. Yes, I did say, I can't say, I mentioned, for example, about the film or the story, I mentioned the story about mace, but I said, because I haven't got proof, this is the only thing what I had a proof about gestion, because our people still alive. I have a maze, but I have no proof to say someone, yes, I have a proof, because he is dead now. Yes, I mean, go and talk to him.
What lessons do you think can be learned?
You know, they can't talk to Schindler anymore. This is why I said, well, that's the part what I... This is the only time I haven't got a real proof. I'm telling something, I haven't got a real proof. You can say, okay, or someone else. But I've got all the others.
Mrs. Wolf, thank you very much.
Sorry, I got a bit upset yet. And bit by bit, I jumped from... Thank you very, very much, you, for listening and for the taste, because it has been a first time ever. Thank you very much, because you gave me the opportunity, first time ever, to sort of get everything out of whatever I was supposed to say years ago. I didn't. It's hard, but you are a very, very, very good listener. Thank you very much. This book contains all the original documents. Real, each one of them is the original, what I carried all the time, either on me or on my body, like my number, and everything is proving through those originals what is on the tape, each word by word, what I'm saying. I've got proof of it. Page by page.
This letter is from?
And this letter is from Prague, from Jewish religious organization.
Stating?
Prague of Verdes. Stating is the date is 7th of April 1965. But obviously it proves the whole situation, and it's proving of my name. I was in my main name, Rönnsburg, when I was born, when I went to Theresienstadt concentration camp, when I came back, name of my brother who was guest in Auschwitz.
And this here?
There is one, another letter proving a little bit all dates, everything. Mm-hmm. Now, there is from it's from the for the police is a proof of all movements wherever I lived from start of the war to the date when I was forced to the concentration camp.
When was this written?
The date. Well, it goes back to...
Was this written before you left Prague?
Oh, yes. It's all those my movements from Jihlava to Prague, from Jihlava to Prague, Zahradní město, from Zahradní město to Španělská ulice, from Španělská ulice concentration camp Theresienstadt, everything, ghettoized, everything. And there is my number, 289.
When was this number given to you?
This was given to me on the day when I received my invitation to the concentration camp. I did get the BD initial and the number 289, but I did get the number 289, what I kept on my around my neck all the time. Even I washed, even if I couldn't wash, I just didn't want to get
it. Still has its original
and
on it.
Everything is in original.
The two
and
yellows.
There is another number. There is another number when I was put into another transport to go to Auschwitz. And again, with the original thing, with everything original. And there are two stars of David, what I had been wearing from start to finish, because I was very, very conservative. I wanted to keep the same. Sorry. Now, there is a proof with a number on, original, of course, again.
This one here? This one?
Yes, yes.
What is this card?
This one and this one as well. It's proving I had to prove whenever I wanted some, if you can call it food. Soup, rationing, it was a rationing.
It says here, Schwerarbeiter Zusatzkarte,
yes,
which
yes.
means a hard
rationing,
labor.
But this
additional.
Was for addition, little bit addition mm-hmm. for extreme hard labor.
And this is for the
and
milk.
This was my mother's Rosa. This was my mother, again, original, because she suffered a touch of tuberculosis. And she got a little bit extra milk. I think it's a milk carton, yes.
This is also your mother's, I see.
Yes, there are only, in the whole thing, there are only two or three. I think only two of my mother's. The rest is mine. And there is one thing from Hanush. I kept it because I wanted to prove. Well, this is the really... Mine, this is the Essen card. This is for vegetaria.
Laundry.
Laundry. Only the very soiled, what we couldn't because we had only cold water, the very soiled washing from the garden.
Mm-hmm. And this here, this document here.
This document is, they call it Arbalis Ausweis, is again BD 289, my number. It's proving how I was working. If I was by any chance not able to work, I had to have permission today, and I had to have a stamp in it. I wasn't working, or I wasn't working, proof, and so on. And it's the other side of it proving.
This yellow card here?
This is a sort of anmeldung, what they call it, to the police, to the whole family, because there is Erwin Arangeburg, Rujan Arangeburg, Rose, my mother Hanush. And my name. It's all Sarah, what is daughter, Sin is son, and my father and my mother, and they date of birth and everything.
And this, I see, has Ghetto Theresienstadt on it.
Yes, this is This is the again, they call it Ausweis. It was inside. We had to have an identity card all the time because we used to be stopped. We couldn't walk, but in the evening, if there was an hour, we had to have a card and every time prove.
The height,
everything,
the color of your hair, brown,
everything, right. Proof, everything.
These two postcards.
This is the other side of the older dates, whatever happened.
These two postcards.
Those two postcards, my father received, and one is in my name. Insights from this is from my uncle, my mother's brother.
Mm-hmm.
He lived in Slovakia but he was a partisan.
And this he sent
he
to Theresia. He
didn't go to concentration camp because he was hiding as a partisan. He was a fighter.
This was sent to Theresienstadt here.
Yes.
And here you have an original stamp from that time.
Yes, and date, there's a date, and everything. Date. He only, I know I was complaining, he got a number wrong somewhere. Sorry, he got a number wrong somewhere.
There's the text.
But there's a text.
And this here.
But there's the other card in my name.
This here.
Oh, everything is original. It's very, very in store. It's really, because that's the proof. This is a proof I just, can you see how it was carry? I was carrying on my body. This is why it got so
tattered. Yes,
because
yes.
Sweating. I was.
When was this?
This was, well, again, there is my number, 289 BB.
Einberufung.
This was your
transport
my first ever, yes, to Theresienstadt. It was the first ever and the first transport. To go further on from Theresienstadt, the first I got invitation here, but this was the first ever for the first transport
to Auschwitz. And here you have
there, and I wanted to get a higher number to be but it was extremely difficult. And as I mentioned on the tape about the hiding and so on, but I was put to in another.
Here is the original number 1341 of the original transport. And here is how you were helped to have a later number of 2190.
That's right. This is what happened. This was my original number. And I was given this number, but it's still for those 2 days I was hiding, but it still didn't help because I was put in another transport. And as I said about the Kursav, about the other thing, I was.
Here you have
photographs
of,
what were the photographs? Oh, we left it on the table. Original photograph.
We'll be shooting that soon from Theresienstadt. Now I see here money.
Yes.
What kind of money was
this is not the one.
Okay, we'll turn the page.
Here
we are.
Yes. This is the real ghetto. Theresienstadt. They call it ghetto Theresienstadt. There is the other side of it as well.
Mm-hmm. This is not the only note. This is not the only note. There are other notes.
All of them, for different currencies, so called.
Mm-hmm.
But it was.
And this was what was given before the visit of the Red Cross.
It was just before, just for the Red Cross. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was useless.
And these are original, obviously.
Everything is original.
Everything is
original. Oh, there was something inside. I left it. This is an. everyone received whoever had some relations outside, could receive a packet. But again, it was a con, because we never got a packet. The only people who some people got Red Cross, but this was supposed to be official. But this was a cover-up for, I don't know if it was, it was obviously for Red Cross, because it was never before. It was either 44 or 45. Oh, you see 45.
Mm-hmm.
It was just before, for everything for Red Cross. It started only before Red Cross. And
December 1997, I'm conducting an interview with Mrs. Edith Wolfe in London. The language spoken is English, and this is tape number 11.
Now I come to across to a document what is certifying returning from a concentration camp to Prague, and there isn't my name, original, of course, my date of birth, where I was born, everything, my signature, and the date when I came back from the concentration camp, what is the 7th of June 1945, because I stayed one month longer than all the others.
When was this issued?
There is probably the date on the other side. Oh yes, it's covered here on the red, must be at the date.
It's very unclear.
Okay. There is, isn't it? I know I was given some money. Oh, here is the money. Oh, just a second. Oh, here is the date. It's the 15th of October. Can you see?
Mm-hmm.
15th of October, 1945.
Right. And here, on this page?
Is it October? How is it possible? Yeah, it is, yes. Oh, this is Hanush's.
This pink one?
Yes.
What is it?
Well, this is again certifying he could get a parcel from some relations. But it was everything what they did. It was, we never received a parcel. Sent, but they confiscated it. They wanted a piece of paper, they wanted to show they are doing things for, but it was everything for Red Cross. It must be the date, either 43 or 44.
Here, can you have a look? 10th of October 1943.
You see? Everything was done.
But it was never received, any parcel.
No way. Right. Well, obviously, they did. I know they sent it. with greater difficulty, but that was the purpose.
And this here?
That's the, you couldn't go even to the shop with the money. You had to have extra coupons, a part of the money, what we received, šatnika pro zaměstnané, for, again, you know, it's...
What does that mean?
Coupons for the shop.
And when
closing.
Was this issued? What year?
I don't know.
It's very unclear.
Unclear. It's so mm-hmm. tiny.
Okay.
With micro.
But I'll tap.
Yes. Those are just roofs of the part or the building where is. The barracks and
of Theresienstadt,
and if you can see the chapel,
yes,
and just to see all of that, it contains barracks and barracks and barracks. This is horrible because this used to be a park. The park disappeared. Because they used to be, they built it a barracks producing maize for ammunition. And before a Red Cross was supposed to come, they restored the park in beautiful condition with flowers, greens, with everything, with benches, with the for orchestra. Everything, not altar, sort of
what are the
stand for orchestra.
What are the people they're doing at that on that shot?
They were forced to sit, literally forced. No one wanted to because everyone knew. This is a shop where it used to be shop. For fabric, selling fabric and dresses and men's suits, but it was closed down after the people left, and it was reopened for the Red Cross to show as a showcase to show how everything is open. We can do shops, and they printed Theresienstadt money, and it was gone.
This also shows the extent of the con of how well dressed the people walking into the shop were.
Obviously, everything, but it wasn't real because it was just for 2 or 3 days, few new things put in and they were taken out. And yes, it stayed open for, I don't know, a little bit longer with all things, but that's it. They even orchestrated a queue. But as you can see, it was incredible. All younger, they asked young people, and they protested. No one would go. They just refused, and they said, kill us. We won't do it for Red Cross. You can see all old people.
Again, all these pictures are in Theresienstadt.
This was everything inside. This was such a terrible con, because it looks like each child has a nurse, like each child is cared for separately, and in real life it was absolutely horrendous. The children were starving, skinny, and not clothed properly, and it was just for a few days. It was horrible. This inside the pavilion where the children for the Red Cross, obviously Red Cross, were sitting and playing, and there's even small something, some for horse, I don't know. But they didn't have really where they normally live in a school with practically no toys, nothing. It was everything done just for it.
I see on the top right-hand side of the picture a little girl sitting on what looks like a rocking horse.
Yes, this is what I said, just a little horse or something. What was everything for Red Cross? Well, they going up, it's inside the building. They are going up, and I was actually, I didn't go upstairs, I was downstairs. But it was everything done for Red Cross, and what they did, all the children were very skinny, and they tried to put in a picture they were least skinny.
Where were the children going to when they were going up these stairs, do you know?
Well, just there was another little room upstairs, but they closed, well, not immediately, they couldn't, they were scared someone will come again. This building stayed for I don't know what happened afterward, but for a long time. You can see how the children are really skinny, they are skeletons. But what they did, they just showcased.
This is a picture, actually, of a sleeping barracks, isn't it, where the children are all lying down covered?
Yes, they put blankets over them because they couldn't hide the whole... I mean, you can see the faces. They are so skinny. They couldn't show the bodies. There was no way. Oh, this is, again, for Red Cross inside the pavilion, the building where they put for those 2-3 days their little children. It shows they playing gladly.
Was this woman who is playing with the children, was she a prisoner or was she a worker or a guard?
There was no one from outside. They were all prisoners. They did work with the children because they wouldn't trust it, the children. They had to know them. This picture is from Jihlava, Iglau.
On the left?
Well, it's on the left side is Hanush.
Your brother?
My brother, who perished in gas chamber in Auschwitz. Next is my mother and myself.
And on the right?
To the right is our... she used to live with us because my mother was working, and she used to care for us and look after.
And approximately when was this picture taken, do you know?
There's a date on the other side. I think it was 36 or 30. I think the date is on the other side, obviously. Well, this is the last picture taken before my father died, and he died on the 14th of April 1950.
And who is that next to him?
Myself. And this was a picture taken, honestly, it was just about months before, six. It was just before he died. Very, very interesting picture. I'm happy to have it. This is the one what I was telling the story about the trucks when they came back from Auschwitz concentration camp, and where we were rescuing them with my friend Hannah from the cattle trucks, and they were the eaten bodies, and she was barely alive, but we saved her.
And
she lives in, she used to be Dolly Stern, but she married in Israel. She's got 2 daughters, and she is now Dolly Bodenheimer.
And she is the and friend that you and your friend recognized and saved.
Our best friend. But she lives, she used to live, this was sent from Haifa. She lives now near Haifa. But I met her in Israel.
And this was taken in?
In Israel, because I...
Do you know what year?
Oh,
I think the back said 1950.
I think so. I'm bit because it was so, oh yes, yes, because it is. I met her, and we were constantly. This is 1933. This picture was taken in 1933. On the left hand side is my father. Next to him is my grandmother, my father's mother, and next to her is my grandfather, what was my father's father. Now, and obviously in front of me is me, in front of them is me. My grandfather died in Theresienstadt, and as I mentioned, my grandmother was 87 years old and she was put on cattle truck. But this was when we got married, William and myself. And obviously he was our best, of my family friend, my mother's friend, and of my father's friend, and our friends. Even William, he liked him very much.
Who is on the right?
This is his sister.
No, the gentleman on the right. What is his name?
It's William, my husband.
On the right.
On the right is Mr. Corti. What is very, very important man, because he had taken all those pictures
that we have seen.
We have just seen about the Red Cross. He was probably the only person who had a camera for official purpose, because he was in charge of sort of Bauhof, the building, everything, and they wanted the photographs of everything, but obviously this was done without their knowledge and permission.
Who is next to him?
His sister.
And next to her?
Myself.
And next to you?
William.
Your husband.
Yeah. Approximately, and it can be, this could be about 75, yes. It was taken about 1975, is my mother in Prague. This picture was taken in 1941. In Prague, it was Studio René, I can remember, and we both, because it was a time when we helped old people with rucksacks on their and our backs, and we felt something is wrong, and we didn't say anything to our parents, and we both went for photographs, to have the last photograph, and it was the last photograph.
And this is a photograph of?
Hanus.
Your brother.
My brother. This picture is taken in Pribislava. It's the little village where my grandfather, my mother's father and stepmother lived.
And who is the man on the left in the white shirt?
Now, the man on the left is a family, it's not a member of a family.
Next to him?
Next to him. This is the woman, what I mentioned, it was the wife, used to be from the youngest brother of my mother, who brought Gestapo to the flat. What I said in my story.
And next to her?
Next to her is my grandfather, my mother's father, stepmother, because he was second time married. And next is the son, her son, and his son, the second marriage, because there were seven children in the first, seven in second.
And the little girl in front?
My uncles and their daughter, she lives in Prague. Now, my two sons, it was taken, I think he was about It was about 63, I think.
On the right?
63. And it's Ivan is on the, Hanush is on the little one, and Ivan is the older one.
Okay. Go.
This is a picture of our wedding, William and myself. In it was on the 4th of June 1952. These are my two sons. Sort of shorter, but he's not short. Is Hanush.
Where Daniel. Is Hanush on the picture?
Hanush Daniel is here.
On the left.
The shorter one on the left. And the on the right is Ivan. This is a book of poems. Not just two pages, but there is a whole book of poems. And there were hundreds of it. What my Bertha Hanush wrote himself in Czech. In the war, just before the concentration camp, but they are at places where there are some in concentration camp, but most of it, I haven't got it, but I've got still a full book of it.
I know you told me yesterday that some of the words, it's written in Czech, but some words that Hebrew. He didn't want anyone to understand,
absolutely.
He wrote in Hebrew.
Because
yes.
He was afraid someone could understand and, mm-hmm. and he would be in trouble. And no one could understand Hebrew, and he was fluent in Hebrew, and he wrote it in Hebrew.